Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the May 11th, 2015 Town Council meeting. Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. Roll call by the town clerk, please.
Chairman Ray.
Here.
Councilor Grennan.
Here.
Councilor Jordan.
Here.
Councilor McCausland.
Here.
Councilor Sullivan.
Here.
Councilor Wagner.
Present.
And Councilor Walsh.
Here.
Thank you very much. Moving on to town council reports and correspondence. Are there any? Jessica?
Yes, Chairman Ray. I represent the town council on the Metro Coalition of Governments, and something that that Metro Coalition has been working on that's very exciting is looking at combining resources for some municipal activities such as fire and fire trucks, things like that. It's a long-term study, and hopefully we'll be getting some preliminary reports very soon.
Thank you. Yes?
Just the firing range committee met last week, and we had received an application from the Sproul & Crowden Gun Club. We made a motion. Our action that was taken was to deem the application incomplete and return it to the Sproul & Crowden Gun Club, having made 7 findings of fact for them to go back and return to us in 1 month with having hopefully a completed application. And our next meeting is set for June 8th, I believe, right?
Yeah, that's correct.
June 8th. So
thank you, Caitlin. Anyone else? No? Okay, great. Then we'll move on to the Finance Committee's report and the links to the dashboard and monthly financial reports. Jim?
Yeah, the dashboard was put online ahead of time, so we don't have hard copies for you today, which, and I just would, you know, direct you to it. That last column where the percent change or dollar change with on track or off, and the notations under each of the sections under revenue and expenditures that gives you some explanation. At the bottom, there's other news. Obviously, the $4.0 million borrowing for the library, the $1.75 borrowing for the 5 school projects, and then our bond ratings at AA1 from Moody's and S&P at AAA bond rating. At the bottom of the page, at the request of other councilors, we have our debt status, and I think that's an important item for us to be aware of. At the bottom of the page, we have the unassigned fund balances, and at our workshop with the school board, there was some discussion about monies that would not be used and turned back to the town, and you can see the municipal unassigned fund balance is $2.9 million, and the school unassigned school reserve is $1.2 million. I think the dashboard is a nice vehicle to understand a snapshot of the financial for the town. I hope that you're finding it easy enough to read and understand, but it is on, it is now published on the website for citizens to see it ahead of time as well. And again, it's even though we're well into it now, it's still a work in progress. If you can see places to tweak it, please let me know. Thank you.
Thank you, Jim. Any questions for Jim? Mm-hmm. Okay. Then we will move on to citizen opportunity for discussion of items not on the agenda. I'm assuming most people are here about the budget, but I will say that if anybody wants to speak to us about something that's not on the agenda, please come forward, and you have 3 minutes per person. Seeing nobody, I will move on to the town manager's report, but I believe I'm going to be deferring to Barbara Powers, who is the chair of our 250th anniversary committee. Thank you, Barbara.
Thank you, and I will try to be brief because you have a long agenda tonight. Thanks very much for this opportunity to give you a brief update on our activities, what's coming up in the next 3 months. I'll come back in September and let you know how the summer's gone and preview for you our September, October, November final events. But first of all, thank you very much for those of you who were able to come to our big kickoff on May 1st when Peter and Thomas Campbell premiered their movie, Cape Elizabeth, Time's Flowing Tide. Those DVDs will be available for purchase at their own website, and that's now on the town's 250 website area if you'd like to grab one of those. I thought they did a terrific job with a pretty complicated past and summarized it in a nice way in a short history video. So thanks very much for coming. We had about a total of about 150 people that evening come out for the four screenings. So thank you for your participation. I have for you, if you were not there that evening, one of the ways the committee is promoting all our activities are through some bookmarks that don't have all the data, but it shows dates. So if anyone is interested in any of these events, they can then go to the town website to read updates. So I'll pass those along. I'll save one to refer to briefly. We've had our two bus tours, North and South Cape, and approximately 70 citizens took advantage of that on the past two Saturdays. And coming up this Wednesday, right in the chambers, will be our Maine State historian, Earl Shuttleworth, who you may have read about recently, is about to retire as the Maine State historian in October. And he'll be speaking about the art and architecture of John Calvin Stevens right here in the chambers. Followed on Saturday by a walking tour of Delano Park that Bob Ayotte's going to lead that will highlight several homes in Delano Park that he designed. And so we're really looking forward to that. We already have 30 reservations for that, and it's limited. So I encourage people to call if they would like to participate. You may also have received this invitation from Pond Cove this week about the dramatic presentation their children will be presenting on Thursday night following the visiting artist Gretchen Berg and all her work with the fourth graders. I went in one day to see Gretchen. She worked in my classroom 20 years ago. And so it was great to see her working with the kids as well as the murals the third graders are working on that will be a permanent installation in the lobby of Pond Cove. They're just outstanding. So if you are able to come Thursday, it'll be a full house, I'm sure. And sadly, we haven't been able to open that fully to the public because with all the parents and grandparents and us, it's going to fill the cafeteria, I think. But take advantage of that if you can. I'd like to make one plug for the Memorial Day Parade. We're trying something different this year, and we're asking what we've determined to be our legacy families to participate along with our veterans and other youth organizations, and I think all of you march as well. And we're calling our legacy families all families who have ties of at least 100 years to this community. And there are many people, including people sitting up in front of us, right, Caitlin, with very long ties to this area. Randy Blake is taking reservations by phone and will have posters made of the family names. So the Jordans will have a poster and the Murrays and the Hannafords and the McClellans and whoever calls to say they'd love to participate. We have a fourth grade class that's been willing to create posters with the family names. So I'm hoping it'll lend a real sort of air of longevity about the commitment people have had to our town. June, of course, Family Fun Day comes along on the 13th. They're going to have a big focus on celebrating the 250, and it'll feature a birthday cake our kindergarten students have made for 250, because that's sort of what kids can relate to. Happy birthday, Cape Elizabeth, right? And they're working on, Debbie Butterworth's working on crafts and games that are old-fashioned for kids to enjoy at that. Followed the following weekend by an ice cream social at Turkey Hill Farm that will also have special activities for the kids. That is a free of charge event. Again, the budget you gave us to work with, we're doling out slowly but surely and covering the cost of most of our events this summer. And then, of course, the Strawberry Festival follows that. The Paint for Preservation auction, which is a Cape Elizabeth Land Trust function, is going to feature a donated painting by Holly Reedy of an historic area of Cape, the whole Spurwink Marsh area. And the proceeds from that will help fund the symphony, which July 25th We're scheduled to have them join us at the fort. Let me give you some update about that, because that was a, you know, Michael and I have spent a lot of time with Bob Ayotte talking about the finances about that, and I'm pleased to tell you we've raised half of the cost of the symphony already here in May. So we're selling 3,000 general admission tickets. We've sold over 800. We've got the 250 circle, and so far we've sold $10,750 of the 250 circle. So buy tickets quickly if you're thinking about participating in that. So our total revenue to date is $71,120, and that includes a projection of trying to have $20,000 in net proceeds for the Children's Garden. So we're right on track. We've had a lot of great media partnership with the Portland Press Herald, Maine Home and Design, and we have a very active Facebook presence, so social media, print media, word of mouth, it's getting out there and the tickets are going, so that's quite exciting. We just need to pray for good weather. And then finally, in August, for our last summer event, there'll be on a much more modest scale, a nosegay-making activity on August 15th at Norm Jordan's farm, where he's going to let people pick flowers, and someone will be there to teach them what it means and to make little nosegays. So I'll come back and talk about the fall after we launch all of this. And again, I appreciate your participation. Any questions for the committee? We meet again next Monday night.
Questions for Barbara?
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. And I would like to add that a big part of our a big part of our funding for the symphony, besides the contribution from our own committee, has been through presenting sponsor TD Bank, but 20 small businesses in Cape, people who do business in Cape, residents of Cape that own businesses, came forth with $500 to $1,500 sponsorships that really put us over the top. So very robust involvement from our business community. So I wanted to let you know.
Thank you very much.
Yes, I'm sorry.
Barbara, the banners on the light poles look absolutely fabulous.
Oh, great. And those were designed by Darren McClellan on our committee. And we walked the street and tied little tape on so Bob Malley and his folks would know where to put them up. And they're quite heavy. They're this fabric. This is one of our other banners that will be carried in the parades. And so it's those colors and that fabric. So I appreciate it. I think they're going to last the season all the way into November. So thank you.
Thank you again. Okay. With the Town Council's permission, I would like to move item 74 up now before the public hearing, and the reason is it's the Boy Scout Camporee item, and it's near the end of your packet. I thought maybe they might like to, we like to do that now, and so they don't have to sit through the rest of the evening. So anyway, the Conservation Commission has recommended the approval of a request from the Boy Scout Troop 30 to host a camporee at Gullcrest Farm on October 23rd to the 26th, 2015, or the alternate dates of October 16th through the 18th, 2015. Is there a motion to accept? Jessica?
I so move.
Thank you. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Molly, thank you. Discussion? And they are here if there's any questions. I don't think they planned on a presentation, but yes, Molly.
I just have a quick question on the alternate dates. Usually we see a rain date and it's a later date, so I'm confused why the alternate date is an earlier date.
Thank you for coming up to answer.
My name is Mark Dorval. I'm involved with the Boy Scouts, and the reason for the alternate date was, speaking with the athletic director and community services, just to make sure that there was no, at that time, any, other sporting events or what would be the best time to, best weekend for everybody to, accommodate us there.
So you don't mind if it rains?
No, weather doesn't matter, during this event. So,
Scouts.
No.
Other questions for Mark? No. Thank you very much.
All right, great. Thank you.
Any other questions by councilors? All in favor? 7-0.
You need to go back to the minutes, too.
Thank you. Okay, then we will go back to now to the draft minutes of April 6th and April 27th of 2015. Is there a motion to approve either both or one? Jessica.
I move that we approve the April 6th and April 27th draft minutes.
Thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
Addie, thank you. Discussion, errors, omissions? All in favor? 7-0. Great. So before we open the public hearing about the budget, I'd just like to remind people that their council decorum requires that there is no applause or otherwise expressed disapproval or approval of any statements made or actions taken at such meeting. Persons at council meetings may only address the town council after being recognized by the chairman. So with that, I will open up the public hearing about the budget. I will ask folks to please line up so we're not waiting for you. If I see no line, I will assume we're finished. You have 3 minutes per person. I have a timer on my phone. Hopefully it works. If it doesn't, somebody else will help. And so when you hear the buzzer go off, if you would please conclude and sit down. So with that, I open the public hearing. Please come up. Just a reminder, too, to give your name and address and any affiliation that you have.
Good evening. My name is Joe Morrissey. I'm the Cape Elizabeth School Board Chair. I have some treats for you. Members of the community, parents, teachers, administrators, members of the town council. We are here this evening to listen to the town council deliberate and vote on a budget number to send to the voters in June for the school board. While we respect the right of the town council to make these decisions as provided for by law, I must express our frustration and disappointment in the lack of respectful dialogue and collaboration that has landed us here tonight. We do not view ourselves solely as advocates for our schools, but as a governing body tasked with meeting students' needs while balancing the needs of our taxpayers. The school budget is built from the classroom up every year with key frontline stakeholders' input, building administrators' oversight, and district-wide prioritization before the school board even sees a spreadsheet. Only then does the board begin with prioritizing all stakeholder needs based on careful planning as laid out in our 5-year strategic plan. It is a long and deliberate process that in 2 leadership meetings between the town council and the school board, 2 presentations of the budget to the council in various conversations, and in any of the 6 public budget workshops, not one town council member gave any constructive input until after all was said and done. That 5 people could derail hundreds of hours of work by our teachers, district leadership, parents, and my fellow school board members strike me as in direct counter to the spirit of the consolidation law intended to give the final say to the voters. There has been a mischaracterization that the school has a windfall. We only wish it so. 80% of our expenditures are salaries and benefits, which are dictated by collective bargaining. Come budget time, we have no flexibility and must meet those increases. This year, that increase was $516,000. This amount reflects the total number of staff reductions, 3.15, which resulted in a projected net savings of $130,177. Thank you. In staffing, which were largely absorbed through retirements. As previously discussed in years past with the town council and its finance chair, the school board has used the decline in debt service expenses to meet the needs of capital improvement projects. This includes allocating $350,000 of that decline in debt service costs to fund capital improvements and deferred maintenance projects in order to maintain current school facilities and reduce the risk of more costly future building renovations. There is also the decline in funding excluding from the state of $250,000. Together, these three items alone offset the often misquoted and misguided description that the school has a million dollar windfall. We have also been asked to bear additional cost of teacher retirement funding, which was previously entirely borne by the state. This year's mandated municipal share increased from 2.65% to 3.25%, a $92,000 expense. We also have non-discretionary IEP needs, PATHS tuition of $14,000, and expenses in the upcoming New England Association of Schools and Colleges team visit for our high school accreditation of a $13,000 expense. This year's budget also includes summer programming, which last year's pilot proved a worthy investment in our most vulnerable learners, not to only maintain their learning over the summer, but to meet mandates in closing the achievement gap. As for declining enrollment, it is largely a matter of distribution. Yes, we have reacted to the decline from the current fifth grade to the incoming fifth grade by reducing one teacher position at the fifth grade level. This was one area of identification where we saw scale back. But the majority of enrollment declines are across the district and do not always fall so neatly into just one classroom worth of students at one grade level. That said, the majority of declines in staffing are at the Pond Cove Middle School, and that is where we have reduced our staffing. Regardless of staffing numbers, there are still fixed costs such as safe, lit, heated buildings, transportation, food, and well-trained and prepared classroom instructors, of which we value utmost. With that said, the town council has asked the school board to provide you with options and the description of that impact of those options in order to reduce the budget by $110,539 in order to reach a 0% tax increase, as opposed to our current proposed tax increase of 0.6%. This is in contrast to the current town council proposed tax increase of a 7.3% as outlined on item 64 in tonight's agenda. Before I proceed with the particulars, I would like to request two things from our town council on behalf of the schools. First, we respectfully request to be held harmless of any further reductions in school budget should the actual state aid come in less than anticipated. This is not a new request. It has been requested, honored, and indeed enacted in years past. Secondly, we respectfully request that should the state aid come in above currently anticipated amounts, that any reductions approved in tonight's meeting be restored upon receipt of those funds, and any additional subsidies then be used for tax relief. Now for our proposals. Option A, please restore our original budget for the 0.6% tax increase. Any removal from this budget only has the effect of transferring costs to subsequent years where our revenues and other expenditures are uncertain. We are currently in negotiations with three collective bargaining units, and the $50,000 in payroll accounting software will only appear again next year. We could earmark those funds this year where we know where we stand and have other anticipated needs done the same. Option B, reduce by $50,000 the budget for the payroll accounting software that the town has chosen not to match this year. And option C, $110,539 reduction accomplished by reducing expenditures in the following areas. Payroll accounting software, $50,000. A half-time human resource director, $35,000, which was originally intended to be shared with the municipal side. Website development by $10,000. Superintendent staff facilities report support, reduced by $10,309, and the Pond Cove Middle School High School non-textbook expenditures by $5,230, part of which includes testing that may or may not be picked up by the state, which then risks pushing those costs onto our families. I thank you for your time.
Thank you. And for those who don't think that I know how to tell time, I gave Joe additional time since she was the chair of the school board. So, but I will ask for everybody to stay at 3 minutes. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Cindy Volz, and I have two children in Cape Elizabeth Schools. I'm here to present the board a petition online that has received, at last count, 60 signatures, asking the board to restore the full budget, asking the council to restore the full budget as proposed by the school board. The proposed budget that was rejected by the council had a tiny 0.6 increase in taxes over the prior year. This increase was the smallest increase by far of any town department and the smallest for schools in several years. And in comparison, a Portland Press Herald article said that most superintendents and town managers in Maine proposed 2016 budgets rising by 2 to 4%. The school board considered a number of factors, including funds, as Ms. Morrissey said, that have been characterized as a windfall. But we were fortunate to have those factors coincide. And the board prudently and thoughtfully weighed all of these factors in setting the proposed budget. This proposed cut will have real impacts, but I feel more significantly is the town council's lack of trust in the school board, the superintendent, and most importantly, the school budget process. The proposed 0% tax increase for schools demonstrates zero faith in the open, fact-based, democratic, participatory school budget process, and it ignores the prudent, thoughtful work of all the participants in creating the proposed budget. The time for a zero increase mandate, if any, is at the beginning of the process, not the end. The council did not propose 0% for all town departments, only schools. We disagree with the town council and support the original proposed budget and the open democratic participatory process used to create it. We urge the town council to reinstate the original budget in full and submit that budget to voters. Thank you.
Ma'am, I didn't get your name and address.
My name is Cindy Volz, 33 Phillip Road.
Thank you.
Excuse me. My name is Bill DeSena, and I'm at 11 Wainwright Drive, Cape Elizabeth. I want to thank the counselors for their dedication and hard work and tough spot that you're in, trying to be fair to all citizens while perhaps offending some of your closest allies, friends, spouses, whatever. But I commend you for protecting the citizens, doing your checks and balances for both to protect us from the municipal as well as the school budget. In my view, this is a pretty simple process that gets convoluted with a lot of details, percentages, and all of that. Some of you may remember years ago, I was one of the participants in Cape Raw. During that process, we were interested in delving into facts before coming up with any opinions. And in so doing, we sat through the laborious and very lengthy process of school budget. As a business fellow, it was very disappointing to me to see how the figures were arrived at, because I'm a strong advocate of the zero-based budgeting to arrive at a responsible level that is required. But the broader picture to me is when moving here 15 years ago, we were definitely a very strong school district. And since then, we've got challenges from the obvious other two. We have had 10 consecutive budget increases on the school side, perhaps on the municipal as well, but we've had 10 declining enrollments, totaling somewhere around 180 students. When I hear that we've cut the staff by one, and I understand the problem of distribution, I challenge if that's enough if we have classroom sizes of 15 divided into 180, comes out to more than one. But I think there's a bigger problem here, and I sensed it because, as some of you know, I am selling my house, and in this, it's been a three-year process. In doing this, we have been number one or two choices. of many home buyers from away. And we have lost on every one of them. And when I've delved into the cause and why over a 2.5-year period, it came down to their alternative choices were more favorable from a tax point of view and equal schooling. That is a hard thing to prove, but it is an omen that all citizens should be aware of, because we have to be very frugal with our budgeting. That is 100% of our school and municipal source. And the other communities at least have a commercial base to draw upon.
Bill, I think, if you could wrap it up.
Okay, sorry, I didn't realize that was it.
That was
so
it.
I respect the school's efforts to have more, but I think it's time that we start collaborating as a community. And when you have a 5%+ gift this year, I see no reason why you need another 0.5% or whatever you're asking for. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Mary Townsend, 5 Pearl Street. I was personally shocked by the council's decision to ask for a 0%. And usually I have my finger on the pulse of what's going on. So this blindsided me. So I went online to try and figure out what happened. And there are no minutes that explain how things transpired. So a few months ago, I was here talking to you about transparency, and I'd like to address that again as one of my points and say, you know, the school board is diligent about filming every single one of their budget meetings because they are taken to task for every single number. And I don't see why this past meeting, where an unprecedented exception happened, was not filmed, so that those of us who are interested in your thought process could follow it. I find it, number one, I find the language of windfall intentionally polarizing. And, I would ask that as a former school board member, when we're talking about checks and balances and pluses and minuses, that we not use a term like windfall. I'm just sort of speaking extemporaneously. I just took a few notes. You know, one of my concerns had to do with this meeting taking place away from cameras, this meeting taking place when the one member of the council who has children in the schools was absent and did not have an opportunity to weigh in, a meeting where at one point there was a tie vote, and instead of waiting for the 7th counselor to come and, give his vote, there was input from the town manager, not the school board chair, about additional funds that the school board wasn't even aware would be made available. So that's 11.5-hour information. My question to you is, the process that's happening. This is such an unprecedented exception, not letting the voters vote on the budget that's been deliberated on for 4 months, and that I can tell you, as a former school board member, is a very lean budget and a fair budget. And I would question some of the numbers I've heard thrown out here today about 15 students in a classroom and one teacher down. I don't think those numbers are correct. So I would make sure that you have the correct numbers. So I'm disappointed in the process. I know you're all working very hard, and sometimes these decisions have to be made, very quickly. But I just ask that you make a decision thoughtfully this evening. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
My name is John Voltz, and I'm 33 Phillip Road. I have 2 children in Cape Elizabeth Schools. I have to echo the comments of some of the earlier speakers to say that I was shocked at the town council's decision. I was a participant active participant in the creation of this year's school budget, and I watched the detail and through which the process was created and each number was examined. And at the very end, they sort of took into consideration, before they have their final straw vote to present it to the town council, if there's any significant changes, anything that takes account of in total, anything different than that budget number. That's what they asked themselves, and they were very rigorous about that process, and the answer was no. And looking at the history of what's been approved by the school voter, by the school budget votes in the last year, I was really shocked that that occurred. But I was shocked. It reminded me of when I was a young financial analyst, and I was working doing solvency analysis, and some very bad actors had very complicated financial statements. I wrote up my analysis, and there was a lot to find. There was a lot of detail. I had to go through it, and I turned it into my supervisor, and it comes back, and it's just covered in red ink. Just covered in red ink. And I was like, what's going on? There's a lot of really important, detailed stuff here. And I was, first, I was really furious. I was like, what's going on? And she'd cross stuff out because she didn't really understand it. And I would ask, you know, I'm not saying that you don't understand it. I know you've done a lot of detailed work. But the time for that participation is during the process, so everyone else who's participating gets to see it. And so I was really mad, and I thought to myself, you know, mad is not going to get me where I want to go. These people, my town councilors, they're my neighbors. They're my colleagues. They're the people I'm going to see at the IGA, sitting at the cookie jar. I need to have a relationship with these people. I was like, I don't want to be mad. I want to solve it. And what I'm asking you to do tonight is to do the right thing. Not questioning your ability to make this change. What I'm saying is, should you? And it reminds me of, if you're sitting there, you finished a long dinner with a close personal friend, you've had a long, difficult conversation, you're down to your last bite of dessert, your last sip of coffee, and you're busy talking, and up comes the waiter and takes it away. You were planning on that last little bit. You wanted to finish off your meal right. It mattered to you. But the waiter thought he knows better than the customer. We close at 8 o'clock. There's a rule. There's a process. Got to follow it. And then the restaurant manager comes over. And they say, what's the problem? And they listen to you. And whatever it is, they make it right. And so, this is your choice tonight. When we're standing there at the IGA or at the cookie jar and we're looking at you, who are we going to see? Are we going to see that waiter who knows better than the customer, who won't send the proposed budget to a vote? Or are we going to see the restaurant manager who does the right thing and makes it right? I urge you to restore the entire full proposed budget. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening, Council. My name is Joe Kozlowski, 31 Park Circle. I'm going to read from a letter that my wife tried to get out to you. Heard a lot of emotion tonight. And I'm not sure if that's positive or negative, but I'd like everybody just take a breath and look at the facts. We're writing this in support of a zero increase. The facts, I'm a small business owner, my wife and I, and in a business that is directly tied to the health of the local economy. During the last 8 years, we've experienced a dramatic decline in our income due to a recession. Due to the recession, we looked closely at all our business and our personal costs, and we made cuts that were necessary to move along. During these same economic challenge 8 years, our property taxes have risen 21%. I don't know how many people in the room have looked at that analysis. The majority of this increase has been to the ever-increasing school budget. Despite the drop in enrollment, these budgets keep increasing year after year. Currently, the school board has been asked to trim a small, or I call it a small, $110,000 plus or minus out of a $23.647 million budget. This is about 0.5%, a little bit less than 0.5% to be exact. Of the budget, which already includes another increase in school costs. To argue every single penny of the proposed budget is ludicrous. I mean, that's what we have the school board for, and that's what we have you for.
Anyone who has worked with a budget knows there are always items in a budget that are not essential. It is time that the school board delineate between the necessities and the wants. Individuals are forced to do it all the time. One of our neighbors, who are an older couple that have lived in Cape for a long time, have just sold their home and are moving out of town. I ran into them the other day and asked them why they are moving. They told me that they needed to move somewhere where they could, quote, afford to live. Clearly, the ever-increasing property taxes influenced that decision. We applaud the town council for representing all of the citizens of Cape Elizabeth in their effort and the responsible spending of our hard-earned money. Please vote to limit the proposed school budget increase to a zero tax increase rate. By the way, I do have two older children that have been through the school system and one currently in the school system. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Elizabeth Seifries, and I live at 22 Longfellow Drive. I would like to extend my gratitude to each town councilor for his or her service to Cape Elizabeth. I know it can be a difficult and thankless job, so I thank you. As a group, you carry the heavy burden of putting together a municipal budget for this entire town. There are competing interests, needs, limitations, and a wide range of taxpayers to take into consideration. A relief from that burden then must be that the school portion of the municipal budget is ultimately voted on by citizens. I'm sure every year the council reflects on the recent voting history and trends of our town so that it can send a school budget to referendum that has a good chance of success. As elected representatives, it must give you great pride that over the past 7 years, your constituents have overwhelmingly voted in favor of the school budgets you have approved for referendum. No one wants multiple costly, embarrassing elections. I urge you to listen to the voters and look at the history. You've been given no reason to think they would not support this incredibly modest tax increase. Given that there is a compromise on the table, which is the original school budget minus $50,000 for the accounting software upgrades, I see this as a win-win. Let's embody the spirit of the One Town concept and opt for supporting all of our townspeople, young and old. Send the compromise school budget to the voters. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening, Cynthia Garfield, Stony Brook Road. I will be brief. I just wanted to say that we did also elect the school board members as well as the town council. We have thus empowered the school board to create a budget. We've asked them to do that. That's their duty. They spent hours in workshops, evenings away from their children doing this. They're professionals. Some of them have even worked in school districts. Some of them have put budgets together. So I'd really like to see what they come up with and have that budget go to referendum to the voters, given that we've empowered that body to come up with those numbers. The largest in the town budget, the largest increase that I see is on the town services going up by $588,000 versus the increase in the school department of $296,000. I was unable to find on the internet what the detail is of that increase, but that's really my focus. So if there's time later this evening, if someone could talk about what the $588,000 increase is, and I thank you for your service as you deliberate.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Dr. Celine Mainville. I'm at 43 Cottage Farms Road, and I'm getting up here to support the budget option A as recommended by the school board. I would like to see that go to the citizens for referendum. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Bill Gross from 7 Seaview Avenue, and I'm also a volunteer tutor at the high school. I tutor the ninth graders in honors physics and the 12th graders in AP physics and calculus. I'm here speaking because I'm in favor of the report that the Town Council Finance Committee put forward, and I hope I'm urging the Town Council to vote to approve it for a $110,000 reduction in the school budget so that there'll be a zero increase in the property taxes for the citizens of Cape Elizabeth as a result. I have two reasons for this. Number one, I think that this is a very special year in the school budget. It's a very serendipitous year. A bunch of circumstances have come together for we actually have a windfall, and windfall is the correct word to use, a windfall savings in the school budget. Number two, I'm afraid of what's going to happen next year. If we don't restrict the school budget this year in any way, then next year we're going to be in a very dire circumstances, I believe. So on point number one, the reason that we have a $1,275,000 savings this year is one time. We're only getting these savings this year. And that's made up of $500,000 from debt service. We will have no such savings next year. We have an increase in state aid of $450,000. It's very unlikely we'll get an increase in state aid next year. We have a savings in fuel because the price of oil went down of $120,000. Again, it's very unlikely we'll get that saving next year, and of course it's very likely the cost would go up. We have a reduction in $60,000 in the charter school tuition. This is a one-time, one-year savings. Next year, they just passed a law in the legislature, and we'll be charged again, not the full tuition, but a good portion of it. And we also had health insurance savings this year of $145,000 that we probably will not have next year. And this totals $1,275,000. Now, it seems to me that in this special year, if the school budget is going to go down by that much, there should be some portion of that should go to the taxpayers. But the school board spent all of those savings and several hundred thousand dollars more for reasonable reasons, but they ignored the taxpayers in the town. And now the only resort of the taxpayers is if the town council comes in and does what I believe is the right thing, take some of that one-year, one-time windfall, and windfall is the correct word, windfall savings, and share some of it with the taxpayers here in town. Now, secondly, next year, what's going to happen to the budget? I've talked with Michael Moore, and I'd like to publicly thank Michael Moore, the finance chair on the school board, because he answered a bunch of questions I had. Even though he and I have different opinions on the budget, he's extremely helpful, very quickly responded to all my answers. If we look at what's going to happen next year, all of the things that he says, you have to look at what we increase this year. And we increased our salaries by $500,000. We increased our CIP by $350,000. And we increased the unadjusted funds by $250,000. All of these things are going to increase again next year. And plus all the things that the savings we had, they won't go to zero. There'll be actually increases next year. So we could look next year at somewhere between perhaps $1.5 million to $2 million.
Can you wrap it up, Mr. Gross?
Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Just remind the audience that I'm doing the timing, so we won't be asking you to help us with the timing. Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Tom Dunham. I live at 11 Becky's Cove Lane. I respectfully urge the council to hold fast to the $110,000 reduction of a $23.6 million proposed budget, school budget. I'm perplexed why the angst over such a small reduction when just two items equate to about $85,000. One is the half person for human resources, and the other is $50,000 for a software program, both of which certainly can be deferred and have no negative impact to the students. I want to thank you for your service and thoughtful consideration and for representing all of the citizens of Cape Elizabeth. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Ann Swift Kayada. I live at 14 Stonebridge Road. Cape schools, for 35 years that I've been in town, have been among the best in the state, and I have no doubt that they will continue to do so, due in great fact to the great teaching staff that we have, and also to a very involved set of parents. I speak as a strong supporter of the schools. I'm a past president of the Parents Association at the middle school. I've been a classroom volunteer, and I am a person who worked hard over the past years on three statewide citizen referendum. I worked to defeat them because I thought they would have terrible effects and would basically gut schools, school expenditures in Maine, including in Cape Elizabeth. So having said all that, I'm here to urge you to stand fast on the Finance Committee recommendation of the $110,000 reduction to fund the school budget. In other words, the school budget should add no increase to current property taxes. Based on the facts as reflected in the school board numbers, right off of their online numbers, over the past 10 years, the school budget has grown 34.7%. That's in nominal dollars. It's almost, it's a little over 12% in constant dollars. Over the same period, enrollment has decreased 13.3%, and those decreases are projected by the superintendent to continue for the next few years. So some more facts that I consider to come to my opinion on this. School revenues in the next year, GPA, will be increasing by $447,000. School expenses, as some other speakers have said, will be decreasing. Debt service, almost $500,000 down this year. Energy costs, $123,000. Charter school tuition, $60,000. If you add up all those expenses, it's $679,000. If you add that to the increase in GPA, you get about, I get, about $1.1 million more to spend in the school budget in the coming year without having any property tax expenditure increase at all. This is certainly enough of an increase, I think. It would more than doubly cover any contractual increases in teachers' salaries. So there's no danger in this of doing anything to the teachers. And all this would be done with a 2.8% decrease in the coming year in enrollment. Clearly, I don't think there's an urgent need for a fiscal year 16 school budget which would add to property taxes. Requiring a $110,000 reduction from their proposed spending is fiscally prudent. It would require no draconian cuts to staff or programs, and it would keep in mind the needs of all Cape Elizabeth people, seniors, single parents, those struggling to recover from the recession, and so on. I thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, Dan Fishbein, Hunts Point Road. Thank you for the opportunity to speak tonight, and thank you for your volunteer service to Cape Elizabeth. You've heard a lot about the supposed $1 million windfall received by the school department. Here are some facts based on what I was able to find on the school budget website. There is indeed good news. The state proposes to pick up $60,000 in charter school tuition and to increase our funding by $450,000. Oil and propane costs are expected to be $118,000 lower, and debt service, as you've heard, declines by $496,000. All of this adds up to about $1.1 million. However, that is only half of the story. The other half is that there are increased costs. Negotiated salary and benefit increases for teachers and staff that were negotiated a few years ago in a collective bargaining agreement, and that's a 2.5% salary increase, adds $516,000 in costs. And that's net of the one-time reduction in health insurance costs. Also, retirement plan costs mandated by the state increased by $110,000. That adds up to $626,000. So what happens to the other $500,000? Most of it, almost $400,000, is returned to taxpayers, because that's the difference between a 1.9% increase in spending and, under option B, a 0.3% increase in taxes. So all the comments you're hearing that nothing goes back to taxpayers are actually incorrect. There's about $400,000 going back in taxpayer benefits from these extra funds. Most of the rest goes into the contingency fund. Why? Because every year the state proposes funding, but typically does not actually come through with that funding. Often that funding is reduced. We still don't have the final funding in June. And then almost every year there's been a curtailment. So keeping a little bit aside for that eventuality makes sense. A 1.9% spending increase is one of the lowest in years and one of the lowest in our area. And a 0.3 or 0.6% tax increase is quite the impressive result as well. I'd also like to point out that the reduction in debt service of almost $500,000 is a budget cut. That means every year there will be $500,000 less spent to maintain and renovate an aging set of buildings. So keep that in mind, too. The school budget has already been cut in another way by that amount. But the amount at hand, I agree with other speakers, is really a small amount, and at the end of the day probably won't make a huge difference either way to the schools or to taxpayers. What will matter are the messages you may or may not send to the voters tonight. Do you respect the careful, detailed work done by the school board and school department? Or do you want to impose an arbitrary cap? Do you want to give the voters the option to vote on the school board's proposed budget as they have for 7 years? Or do you want to set a precedent that now what we'll be voting on is the town council's budget? Do you want to once again, after 7 years of collaboration, divide the town on this issue? Our community has supported the school board's budget with a nearly 70% majority for the past 7 years. That has been true in elections with both high turnouts and low turnouts, reflecting the strong support by our entire community for education. Let's continue that good result. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Sarah Lennon. I live at 54 Cranbrook Drive. Thank you all for your hard work and listening to us tonight and letting us speak. I'll be brief. It seems to me the central issue here is how small this sum of money is that we're all debating over. We're basically just, when you look at it in the big picture, we're disagreeing about a minuscule amount. The overall budget for next year is $35.2 million. The amount of money that you are asking the school board to cut with the compromise budget is $50,000, or 0.13% of the budget. Considered in a practical context, it's basically irrelevant. It'll return $11 to the average household next year. So what are the real issues? Well, from where you sit, you're probably thinking it's about setting limits, saying enough is enough, finding a year when maybe it's possible or it makes sense to ask for no increase. You're probably thinking, let's just cut the 50K and move on. But from where we sit, it's puzzling that you have set essentially an arbitrary number as a goal for our schools, but not for our town services, that somehow 0% increase should be our collective goal. But I don't think you have consensus or even a majority who agrees with that premise. Based on prior year's voting results, the majority of Cape residents are perfectly happy with a modest annual increase to keep our schools strong. Over the past 7 years, an average of 68% of voters have approved an average of 3% increase each year. Looked at in that context, this year is far less than many of the previous year's increases, and I can only presume that voters would once again turn out and overwhelmingly vote in favor of it. So I leave you with this question. Are you standing by the zero because you genuinely feel that's what's needed to ensure the long-term fiduciary health of our community? Or is it based on an ideology which renders the on-the-ground numbers irrelevant? In either case, are you willing to create the conflict and tension that will surely result from this symbolic gesture on the eve of our community's 250th celebration? Thank you.
Can you hear me? Yes?
Yes.
Polly Wilcox, 17 Cape Woods Drive. I just thought I should mention an opinion that this is not research-based, and I'd like to give research-based opinions, but I can't. This is going door-to-door running for House of Representatives for the town of Cape. I learned some things So this is anecdotal, but I thought I should speak for the people who did vote for me and were concerned. I heard a lot about people being worried about whether they could stay here in Cape, the elderly, that is. I work with the elderly here in Cape. But the cost is very difficult for them, and it's getting harder, and even for the families who are supporting their families staying here in their homes, it is difficult. I also heard many times, I'd rather not speak up because my opinion is not that popular. I don't know which is the right thing to do. I think the schools were great to my kids, and they both have successful lives a good deal because of Cape Elizabeth. I just would like people to understand that there's goodwill on both sides. The school board has broken their necks, and you do too. I don't know who spends more time doing which. I learned, if anything, last fall that it's a lot of work to run for public office, to do public office, and one can be an easy target for criticism. So I would just like to say, whatever happens, could we all remember that we're all trying to do the best for our town and our kids? The end.
Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Tim Thompson. I live at 6 Pine Ridge Road. And a lot of what I was going to say has already been pretty clearly laid out by some of the previous speakers. But I do think some of the things that we haven't mentioned, and Polly just mentions it a little bit, but I think tone is important. And to suggest that the town council is somehow in the basement secretly meeting on this issue is just, I don't know where that comes from. But I know there's a great deal of transparency amongst this town council. Some of the terminology that we began hearing 8 years ago was a one town center or a one town concept. And you know, when you have 8 years in a row or 7 years, however many years, where we have seen the town council year after year after year approve the school board as it's come forward, we don't want to go back to that year that the first school board budget that came to us was 13% and we ended up with a 6% and we had to go to. I just don't want to see those kind of battle lines being drawn, because that didn't help school. It didn't help our town. The tone was bad, and it took us many years to recover from that, to get the trust back to where it was, where the school and the town really worked closely together. It was encouraging to see the town and the school be able to figure out that it made sense to, as we've done with Scarborough, share an assessor and receive some savings. The town council, I think, should be really congratulated on that. I was encouraged to see another sharing of a position with an HR person. But I think we need to also take an opportunity to look at how many people in this town don't have children in the school. There's a big, big percentage, a significant majority, that don't have children in the school, yet they, year after year, as it's been pointed out many times, they support that school budget every time it comes through, and they'll continue to do that, because like me, we've all benefited from this great school system that we have. But I think there's also an opportunity, and I think it's almost a principle, when our town finance chair does communicate to the school chair, finance chair, that we'd like to see a zero budget increase this year, I think that communication does it. You guys don't have the legal right to tell them where to cut, but you do have the right to kind of give them a general idea of where you'd like to see this come in. Give the taxpayers the opportunity, almost like a thank you, for all the years you had supported everything we've asked for, to this year, out of principle, give us a 0% increase in the budget. A $50,000 simple item on that would be one that was put in the budget at the very last, almost the last night they talked about it, was $50,000 in savings that they got from the health insurance plan. I mean, and that's not on anybody's cost cut idea, but a $50,000 not going into the contingency fund, raising the contingency fund from $180,000 to $230,000 seems like a simple one, you know, but I think there's easy ways, without drawing the battle lines here, to be able to get to where we need to go, because I don't relish the thought of the kind of lawn signs and budgets being put together to battle over $110,000, but the principle's important, and the taxpayers in this town deserve a little thank you and a 0% increase. So I would really appreciate it if you'd stick to what you've decided. I think it was responsible. You're doing your job. You're doing what you're legally required by the legislature and the state. And I appreciate all that you do for us. Thank you.
Thank you. I see nobody else. Is there anybody else that wants to speak? Yes? Please don't leave us hanging waiting.
I'm Amy Partridge Barber. I live at 7 Charles Road. So I came here to listen. I didn't have any particular agenda or plan, but I listened, and I have 2 boys in the school system. I am immensely grateful for this school system. I grew up in a private school in Baltimore, Maryland, and I never thought my kids could get the kind of education that they're getting here in a public school, and it's just blown my mind. I mean, I'll never forget the night I was at the open house when my son became a freshman. And I cried when I heard the teachers speak, because these teachers cared so much about these kids. And you gotta pay teachers well to feed their families, to make them feel committed that their jobs are valued, they're cared about. And when you feed people, they spread that. So if you feed your teachers, if you feed your school system, then you feed your community and you feed your children. And I know that our teachers feel valued and appreciated. And I don't know the numbers and I don't know the math, but as I'm listening tonight, I'm hearing lots of different perspectives. So there are people here who care. There are also a lot of people who aren't here who care. And I would like to bring the school board's proposal to a vote, because I think we should ask our town what they want. And I think our town will tell us what they want. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? You sure? Okay. And I'll close the public hearing. Before we move on to the next item, I would like to ask the finance chair to give a small discussion of the process. Finance committee's process, the budget process as it pertains to the town council, since there seems to be some questions.
Well, thank you, Kathy. This would be my 6th year of going through this budget process. We have tweaked it along the way, and in the last 2 years, we've taken a little different approach to it, but the actual schedule for budget review is established in December when the new council is sworn in to office. And part of the process we now have in the evaluation of our manager, we expect our manager in early January to give us a sort of overview. Where does he think we'll be? Where are we going? What are the sort of key drivers that we need to be concerned about? We asked him to do this for a couple of different reasons, because we felt that the direction that we as a town council should be clear and concise, especially as every department head goes about the job of creating a budget and then presenting it to us. In my previous years, before we changed this system, we would get a budget that was created without really the kind of direction from the town council that I felt, and then ultimately my colleagues feel, is appropriate. The budget this year, we had 5 dates. We had the 16th of March, the 18th, the 7th of April, and the 27th, and then the 29th. The March 16th and 18th dates, these were workshops. They're held in whatever room is available in this building. They are not televised. They are not filmed. And there are minutes taken, but they're simply action points. April 7th was a new date for us, because when we published the 27th to review the school board budget, the director of community services was not available. And that's the night we would have gone through his budget. Because we as a town council feel that we should have that department head present, We rescheduled that event, and it took place on the 7th of April. Again, it was a workshop. It was not televised. It was not filmed. And there are minutes and action points that were captured by the clerk. The 27th was the date scheduled for the school board. Each one of us got this book from the school board after they had approved their budget several days in advance of the 27th. This is what we got. And you can see all my sticky notes so that you can understand the budget process for the finance chair is a rather interesting one and an important exercise because my peers are looking for some understanding of what's taking place and what guidance there might or might not be. Something happened different this year than happened last year. Last year, I met with John Christie, who was then the chair of the town school board, and I went through this budget line by line with him, and we talked about the budget, why, how it was created, and I thought that was a good exercise. This year, because of vacations between Michael Moore and myself, that wasn't able to happen. I watched on television all the budget meetings. Thank you for having them televised, and I appreciated that very much. This year, I did communicate to Michael a few times before the 27th, the things that were left over from last year's budget, questions we still had, and the school board did a fabulous job of answering those questions in the presentation they made for us on the 27th, and I very much appreciate that. I also sent an email to Michael, and I sent a link to him for the results in the forecaster from the town of Yarmouth's discussion at the school board and town council level as it pertained to their savings in insurance. And I just simply indicated to Michael he might want to take a look at it, and it might be something that would come up in a discussion with the town council here. So, again, when I read all these emails and people sort of talk a little bit about what was or wasn't communicated or could have been communicated or whatever, but anyway, the meeting took place on the 27th. It was held in the new conference room downstairs, which the school board's very aware of the fact that we had to move that entire crew out of there because of mold. But we felt that it was the appropriate place given the fact that it was a room big enough to have a larger group. The planning board was up here in this room. So we continue to have our meeting downstairs. We felt it was the right thing to do. And we had all but two school board members present. We had the superintendent and all of her department heads. So it was fairly well attended. This is the standard process. The 29th didn't happen because we felt that we could make a decision to move the number, which is the only control we have, to a public hearing today. And we combined that meeting on the 27th with the discussion, which was 2.5 hours long with the school board. So there was no smoke and mirrors, no smoking rooms, no down in the back bowels of this building. It was all done, in my opinion, transparent. And the way that we've done business in this town, at least in the 6 years that I've been on this board. So I think it's important just to keep a context here that I feel very strongly that this was all up front. It's been published on the website, well known by everybody. And I just felt that it was important to at least state that. The other thing I think it's also important to recognize is that the votes that have been taken in validation have not been, the numbers have been floated here, 65%, 70%, 71%. When you have 983 people voting with 7,000 citizens who are registered to vote, it's very difficult for me to get my head around people telling us that it's overwhelming, or even a supermajority, which is something that someone stated before. I think the citizens of this town deserve this budget. They deserve, and they have the right legally to vote on it. But this town council has the right to review that number presented by a group of professionals who did a great job. And at no point is this to discredit anyone at the school for what you've presented to us. We are doing our fiduciary responsibility. It's what we were elected to do. And if we didn't do it, I think people would have more to complain about. So Kathy asked me to present that, to at least just give a backdrop, because again, as chair of the Finance Committee, I own pretty much all of this. But I felt it was important to at least present to all of you the way it transpired, because there was a lot of misinformation about how it happened. Just before this meeting started, I had somebody who spoke tonight talk about the fact there were a couple of votes. The first presentation of vote on the 27th was 3-3. So then it was tied, so we presented a new option. We came out 3-3. And then the town council decided to work a compromise amongst itself, and that's where we come up with $110,539. Discussions about the fact that why didn't we wait for Jamie Wagner to come back from France? I find it interesting at one level, but he wasn't there. I can't control that. That was his decision. He's here tonight. I'm glad we have seven members up here to make the decisions that we need to make. So long and short of it is the process, I think, is a good one. The next time, I think we'll make sure that we have our meeting up here, not in the basement, because I think people drew a lot of conclusions about that I don't really think are accurate. So, thank you.
Thank you, Jim. Okay, then we will move on to item number 58, 2015, which is the municipal budget. Yes, Jim.
I move that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, having held a public hearing on Monday, May 11th, 2015, to hereby adopt the municipal budget for fiscal year 2016 and hereby makes the following gross appropriations for each of the listed departments, which is contained in your packet in front of you.
Thank you, Jim. Is there a second?
Kathy. Yes, Chairman Ray, I'll yes. Second.
Thank you. Discussion. Jim?
Kathy, we had a citizen who asked a question about a $580,000 increase. I wonder if the manager might be able to address that for that citizen.
Chair, thank you. Yeah, the municipal budget is primarily impacted this year by the voter-approved library debt service expense. That is about $316,000 of the projected increase. In addition, there's salary wage adjustments. They're 2.5% for most employees and 1.5% for those in the public works bargaining unit. However, they did get another percent in retirement contributions, so it adds up still to 2.5%. Capital needs. The council has had a goal looking at long-term capital needs of increasing it by $100,000 each year, recognizing during the recession when the budgets were really cut back that we weren't addressing roads and other things. Anyway, this year we only put $50,000 increase in rather than $100,000. Health insurance is up $40,000, and it's not because of the rate increase was only 1% or 2%. What happened was that the demography of the employees in the health retirement system changed. Some employees retired who weren't getting family coverage. People came in who were getting family coverage. We had single employees who got married. It was simply demographics that caused that to up. Workers' comp is up $30,000. That is because of the experience. We've had a number of school employees, a number of municipal employees, who have had long-term issues with great expense, and as a result, that expense went up for each of us. There was a proposal for an HR assistant that we were going to share We had already had some HR monies in our budget. The school board had $35,000 in. We had $25,000. The plan was to hire someone in there in the 40, high 40s probably, but with benefits and all the other costs, health insurance, it would have, the estimate was $70,000. There was also, you know, $10,000 increase in legal services, $7,000 in Social Security, and $5,000 in streetlights as a result of electricity expenses for streetlights. And that, I think that more than adds up to more than the $500,000.
Thank you. Other questions? Comments? Okay. Anyone? Oh, I'm sorry. Amy, I'm sorry.
You didn't have about the school budget part of this now? Or
we're going to do that time. Next. Yep. Any other questions about the municipal budget? No? All right. All in favor? 7-0. Okay. Then we will move on to item number 59, 2015. Jim?
Yeah, I move that the town of Cape Elizabeth hereby agrees to accept the following estimate of state and federal funds. And what I want to state to you is that that second line is an error. And the rest of the document that you have in front of you, the between the town manager and the superintendent of schools, there are some dates in there that state 2014 and 2015. They should read 2015 and 2016, and that's repeated twice on the next page.
Okay. Thank you, Jim. Is there a second? Jessica?
A second.
Thank you. Discussion? You want, this is the time if you want to say okay. Something about the school
not
budget.
Just about the estimate part of this. It's the whole thing?
Yes.
All right. First, I'd like to thank the citizens and that spoke tonight. I appreciate the opinions of everybody. It looks like they've well thought out opinions on both sides. I want to say that I respect the views of my fellow counselors, and sorry I wasn't here for the last part of this, but I was out of the country. I just got out of trial today in Boston and listened to a damages expert talk about fixed and variable costs, and I think it had something to bring to bear in this conversation today. Just because there's declining school enrollment does not necessarily mean that you have a proportional amount of savings associated with that. You have a certain amount of fixed costs that are going to stay the same. So you can't just say, because we have declining school enrollment, we therefore should have the same amount of savings associated with that. It doesn't work that way. During the budget process this year, I sat with the other counselors and I listened to the department heads for all the different town departments. And we had a nice, very thorough discussion of all line items on all the different budgets. And during the course of that, you know, we accepted all the budgets for the different town departments. And at the time, I thought we were accepting the budget for the town school department as well. So it did come as a surprise to me, and I heard about it when I was in France, that there was some debate that I had not realized was going to occur because it hadn't been discussed previously. And I know that a lot of us are big fans of making sure that we vet these things beforehand. I know Jim's a big fan of that. And that we should discuss these things when we had the opportunity beforehand and not decide at the last second. And I understand there was some debate back and forth and that it was originally 3-3, but that the 0% forces prevailed. Now, I don't see any magic to a 0% number. I agree with the speakers today that said it was an arbitrary number. It is an arbitrary number. It doesn't reflect responsible government to me to just say 0%. Why not negative 2%? Why not positive 2%? Why not negative 10%? Why not positive 10%? It depends on what the needs are or the lack of need is. Mr. Gross would probably agree with a further reduction. But 0% has little meaning to me other than kind of a no new taxes pledge, George Bushian sort of I don't agree with that. It doesn't make sense to me intuitively or intellectually. You should base it on what the needs of the school system are, and so I disagree with that wholeheartedly. I asked Michael about a couple days ago about the budget submitted by all the other departments, and he confirmed that the town council didn't request decreases in any of the other departmental budgets. I also find it notable that shortly after the town has approved the $4 million+ library project, that it's now that we choose to come after the schools to rein in spending. Finally, I note that the school board, I think it was Joe that was talking about the reduction of a teacher in fifth grade. And I, from what my understanding is, the school board cut holy heck for that from a lot of town citizens, that they shouldn't be reducing that teacher. So they were being fiscally responsible by trying to cut back on the amount of teachers in the system given the decline in enrollment. And they got a lot of grief for that. And, you know, fair enough from the citizens that thought that was too much of a reduction. But, you know, there's two sides of that one as well. But I think that, given what I've heard, that the middle road option makes the most sense to me because of the $50,000 reduction because of the accounting software. So I would propose that we go with the option number B, where we reinstate approximately $60,000 to the school budget.
Thank you, Jim. Caitlin?
I'd like to say I agree with just about everything Jamie had to say. In my perspective, I would have rather see if we were going to go after the decrease from any departments, that we should have been requesting them and decreases from other departments on our municipal side. Even though our budget is so much smaller compared to the school budget, we should have been going across the board on our requests. We also should have been slightly more upfront about a request for a 0% increase from the school board, if that's what we were going to be looking for a couple months ago. There's nothing to stop us from saying or communicating to the superintendent or the school board that this is something that we'll be looking for, this is the number that we'll be looking for, since that is all that we can control. As much transparency and process we have, I don't remember hearing in Jim's explanation when that occurred, or if anybody has an email or a conversation where we said we're going to be looking for 0%. As Jamie pointed out, we did not ask for a decrease in any other department. We did not do a 0% increase in anything that we did on our side. So it was a very big blind side, in my opinion, to the school board on April 27th. I agree with Jamie about option B. I think it's a great compromise, since that's what we were talking about at the last workshop, compromising, since it appears that the software update will not be happening based on communications from our town manager in the next year. Let's push those funds to the next budget, and next year's budget will just be slightly higher. But it seems to be the greatest compromise, in my opinion, at this point.
Patty.
I guess I'll weigh in. I agree with Jenny's sentiments and Caitlin's today. I find like this whole process to be, listening to everybody, what they've said here, and it's interesting to me, being a first-year town councilor, that we are fighting over, not say fighting, but discussing and having a dialogue over, you know, $110,000 in a $23.6 million budget. So what that tells me is that basically we all enter this dialogue with a certain perspective or a lens we're looking through. And one side is saying, you know, it's $110,000. It's easy to cut. Just to cut something, and you should be able to do this, and it's not a big deal. While the other side is saying it's really easy to approve. It's such a small amount. We're barely increasing, and so it really is the lens that we're looking for through that kind of informs our thought process. I want to say that I did find school board's proposal on our last meeting to be very thorough and thoughtful, and that I think that they're, and where I've landed is that they are an elective body that we have, as we heard earlier, it has been empowered to really sift through all the issues and the pressure points and the pieces of the school board budget as it relates to achieving, you know, an approved mission and vision for the schools, and looking at how our schools are, you know, looking at what is needed to make sure that our kids get the education they need to be successful. So as far as process, I think it was a transparent process. I don't think it's a fair statement to say that there's anybody hiding from it. Things were published. But could we be better at it? Yes. Could there be, and if we are going to look at making cuts in the future, you know, we, notably, the school budget, school board budget, or the school budget has, you know, increased since 2003 by 50%. We are on a rising incline, and I don't think that that's truly sustainable for our town. We need each other to have this conversation and figure out what that's going to be, and make sure that we're able to have the dialogue about costs, and it hopefully won't be contentious. So, having said that, I am in favor of restoring, you know. I left that meeting, the school board meeting, thinking that we would be able to have some options. I'm really pleased that there are options on the table. And I am in favor of budget option B. I think it's a compromise. Overall, that's what I'd like to see happen this evening.
Thank you, Patty. Mm-hmm. Jim?
Kathy, a point of order. The motion that's on the table is the budget that was sent to this meeting for the public hearing.
That's correct.
Which does not include, it's minus the $110,000.
That is correct.
$539.
Yes.
So, just point of order.
Understood. Did you want to say something? No. Okay. Molly, yes?
I know Mrs. Lennon found us to think about whether we are willing to create a fund for $110,000. And we also heard from a number of people who said, and I believe this myself, there is a great deal of goodwill on both sides of this issue. It does not need to be a divisive issue. I'm not happy with the process. I'm not happy with the number of the emails that we are getting and with the messages that are coming to the council as we stand up to do the job that we were elected to do. But I would like to just toss this back out and say that we do trust you on the school board. We do trust that you have done the hard work, and we respect that. And we do trust you with the proposed $23,536,649. That's a lot of trust. So I think we all need to be open on both sides to understanding that. We're not up here trying to be difficult or to be mean. I cannot stress that enough. The emails that we have received indicating that this has been a process held in smoke-filled rooms. The room that we held the meeting in was downstairs. I would challenge anyone in this room to go down and take a look at it. It's a lovely room. It was not smoke-filled. There's nothing, anything other than above board going on in this process. I want to be very clear about that. Thank you.
Thank you, Molly. Anybody? Nope. Jessica?
Sure. I'd like to say a few words. That I recall, we got our budget, I think it was less than a week before April 27. I went through mine extremely carefully, as I always do. I thought we had a very productive meeting. It was in a lovely room. It wasn't in a dark basement room. It is not the town council's practice to film workshops. If the school board had asked us to, which they did not, we would have gladly tried to accommodate them. But again, these emails that we've been getting accusing us of underhanded, lack of transparency, lack of democratic process have been really quite astounding. You know, I'd like to echo Councilor McCausland. We do trust the process. This is a $23.5 million budget. The school board budgets have been going up year after year after year. The town council has held its to zero before. In February 2011, I was on the council. I'm also with Jim. This is in my sixth year, and I remember vividly the school board coming to us in the dead of winter. We need a new boiler. Would you please fund it? And we did. And you came to us again. We'd like to have some money for our capital improvements and maintenance. So we just bonded and borrowed on your behalf, or the town, the school department, on $1.75 million. I think that this town council has been very supportive of the school department. And I think that some of the emails that we've been getting from, including people that used to be on the school board who have claimed that we have short-circuited the process, just astounds me, because the process is identical to what it has always been since 2008. I think that what we are asking for, and I'm definitely in favor of, is extremely reasonable. It is merely a decrease in your increases. And I think that given the fact that, and I will echo Mr. Gross, this is a special year. You have had a windfall. And I think that this is something that would be very prudent to do. I think that it will be very easily done without affecting any student learning in the classroom. I think that $447,000 in unexpected state subsidy funds, $143,000 in unexpected reduction in insurance premium costs, $123,000 unexpected reduction in energy costs, $60,000 unexpected reduction in charter school tuition costs, and $496,000 in retired debt. I do believe very strongly that we are just merely requesting a reduction in your increases, and I think this is perfect year to do that, to say thank you to the Cape Elizabeth taxpayers who have supported the school district so strongly for so many years. And it's a wonderful school district. My kids were in it too. So I'm very much in support of this effort, and I do hope that those who have been targeting the town council and claiming smoke and mirrors and all this crazy stuff would please remember the facts and the truth. And so that's what I'm going to say.
Thank you. Jamie? I was going to say Jim.
Again, through the chair, to you, Jamie. I mean, it seems to me if you're going to make a motion.
I was going to make a motion.
Yeah, okay. That was the reason I asked the point of order.
I was just waiting for the
Yeah, okay, great.
Did you want to say something first?
No.
Okay. Jamie, did you want to say something?
Yeah, I'd like to move to amend the pending motion to change it to original school board recommended budget less the $50,000.
Is there a second? Patty? Sorry. It's getting a little loud. Backing up. Thank you. Discussion about the amended motion.
On the amendment,
excuse me. Thank you.
Point of order?
Yes.
Based on our new code of ethics, I don't know that Jim has disclosed his relationship to the school system.
Okay. Jim, did you want to address that?
Unfortunately, that should have been done before the budget season and before the first meeting, I guess, with the community services and with the school board. My wife is a teacher. She's a fifth grade teacher. I think she'll be protected on the fifth grade team, but I don't know that because there's going to be a reduction of one. I don't really have any control over what happens or doesn't happen in the schools, so I raise the issue and I present that to my peers for your review and your decision.
Do we need to vote on that?
The council wants to.
Does the council wish to vote on Jim being able to vote on the budget?
I completely disagree with Councilor Wagner. I see no issue here. Councilor Walsh has never recused before, and I think if Councilor Wagner wanted to bring this up, you should have done so long ago.
No, I didn't request his recusal. I requested that he disclose it.
Disclosure? Okay.
Yeah. I thought that Jim had previously recused himself from school budgets.
Brought it up, but wasn't recused. I just brought it up. Disclosure.
Year.
Yeah.
Okay. Sorry. Every year you brought it up and disclosed it that I have been in the council since 5 years now. So I think
just Jamie was saying, our new code of ethics guides have made several disclosures so far already this year. I think that's all he was requesting, recusal.
Yep.
Okay, so we have an amended motion.
No, you have an amendment on the floor to.
We have an amendment on the floor.
To add $50,000 to
Thank
the school
you.
Notes.
All right, so we need to either discuss, we need to first discuss and or vote. Does anybody want to discuss it? All right, so then we think, Mike, help me out. We're going to vote on.
You're now voting on Jamie's amendment to add 50,000 to the, no, to add six, yeah.
Yeah.
Minus 50. Yeah, exactly.
What
Thank
she
you,
said.
Meredith.
to go with option B, is that?
Yeah.
Okay. So all in favor of going with option B? All opposed? The amendment fails. Back to the original motion. Anybody else want to say anything? I will. There's a lot of things that have been said tonight, and I don't want to repeat most of them. I will add a couple of things. First of all, I'm the one that made the original motion to reduce the school budget by $100,000 and $539. I won't forget that number soon. And I don't have any problem with that motion that I made to the Finance Committee. This is my 12th year as an elected official, and I was on the school board for 8 years, including 2 years as chair. And I understand the budgeting process that they go through, and they work very hard. I think we've heard that this evening. And I do support the schools, and I have for many years. I went to school here, my husband went to school here, my daughter went to school here. And I also support the citizens of Cape Elizabeth, and I'm thoughtful about the good stewardship of their tax dollars. Considering the $1.1 million windfall, and I will use that word again because I believe it's correct, I don't think it's unreasonable, because it's such a unique year, to ask for the $100,000 back. I don't think it's necessarily going to happen again in the near future, and I think it's something that sends a message to the taxpayers that we are thinking about everybody, school citizens, elderly people, single people who are trying to put braces on the teeth of their children, and everybody in between. It's been also brought up that they're, why aren't we reducing the municipal budget? And I pulled out some information, and over the last 15 years, the municipal budget has averaged 2.6% increase, and the school has averaged 3.7. Those are percentages, not dollars, obviously. The other thing that I wanted to reference, and I've heard it said a couple times this evening, but it's sad that some of the emails that we've received, some of the coverage in the media, because I don't consider us cowards. I don't consider us shameful. I don't consider us dishonest, immoral, or shirking our responsibilities. Our responsibilities are to do what we're doing this evening. And however that comes out, this is what we're supposed to do. And we do work with the school board. And if we don't always agree on the number, we can agree to disagree without being disagreeable. So I'd like just wanted to say that, because I think that's important. So, and I think, Jessica had mentioned, but it was brought up by somebody this evening that we're not supporting keeping the buildings up to date. But it was brought up, and it should be said, that the numbers are that we did just give them $1.75 million for new roofs and a boiler at all three school buildings. So we are trying to make sure that we're good stewards of the buildings that we own and are responsible for. So I will be voting in favor of the reduction of the motion on the floor, which is to reduce the school budget by $100,539.
$110,539.
Thank you. Thank you.
It's getting catchy.
Yeah. Anybody else want to say anything? No. Yes, Jim.
Full disclosure, this is a very difficult decision for me.
you know, again, I believe the schools are an intricate part of this community and an asset that every one of us is proud of. And we, when we raise $1.75 million in bond, it's not for you, it's not for me or us, it's for all of us. And I just want people to understand that. And this is a tough, tough decision, but again, and I don't call it a windfall, I call it a swing in the way the monies came through. But I just feel really passionate about this, and I know school budgets. I was a principal of a school, taught school 10 years. You know, there's a lot of blood, sweat, and tears that have gone into creating this, and the checks and balances and the internal conversations and the pushback and the tension that exists. That's all great. That's what you're supposed to do. But in our chair where we sit, that same healthy tension exists. And if we don't do what it is we should be doing here, I'm not sure we're responding to our fiduciary responsibilities to every citizen in Cape Elizabeth. And I have to tell you, you know, this is this grates at me at many levels. But I do think it's the right thing for our citizens. I hope people understand that, you know, we had the conversation. We had a $50,000 delta because of the software. The school board offered the potential of a $35,000 delta as a result of the HR person. We can do something different. So we're looking for $25,539. I mean, anybody who's put a budget together in any capacity, even your own checkbook at home, to come up with $25,539 on a $23.5 million budget, I just don't get it. It just defies logic to me at every level. So all the discussion, and you know, and I sat in the back of the room and I watched Jeff Shedd talk about testing and the fact the state's going to support it or they don't support it or we're going to support it or we're going to get rid of statistics books. We're going to do, you know, at the end of the day, this $25,539, it's not going to get anywhere near your testing program or statistics books. But, you know, those are the kind of emails we've received. And the very first email we received, we were called disgusting. That was the word, the very first email. And I'm thinking to myself, wow. this is supposed to be a great community with civility that is second to none. But it's interesting how it all came out at the same time the Westbrook Town Councilor decided to diss the governor. And then in the Boston Globe last week, the town of Sudbury, which is just like Cape Elizabeth in so many ways, had to hire an outside consultant to improve civility in the town because the chairman of the town council had 3 toilets delivered to their doorstep as a result of a vote that was considered not popular. So I want you to understand, I'm very passionate about doing the right thing for Cape Elizabeth. And I think this vote tonight is the right thing. And I know that our professionals in the schools will do the right thing with this message. And my hope is that we don't have a firestorm between now and June 9th. It's going to cost us $6,000 to have that vote. I don't want a repeat performance of 2008, but the voters will decide. Is it right? Too high? Too low? So I'm ready.
Okay, thank you. Anybody else want to say anything? Yes.
One of the budget cuts I see on here is the website upgrade that's going to be taken out.
I was very disappointed by that because having tried to navigate the Cape Educational website, it's difficult. But given all of the wonderfully educated students that have come out of Cape Elizabeth because of our great community, maybe there's somebody out there with some computer technology skills that might want to help. As Jim had said, maybe people can open their checkbooks to $25,000 and bring the budget back up. But Maybe there's somebody out there smarter than me that can help with our website.
Thank you. Anyone else? No.
I'd just like Jamie? To say I hope the council endeavors next year to make sure to coordinate with the school board about budget cuts at an earlier point. I think that'd be important to the relationship between the council and the school board.
Thank you. Anything else? No? All right. All in favor of the motion on the table? Anyone opposed? The motion passes. Thank you. We're going to be moving on to a group of items 60 through 73 in block. I think we'll wait just a couple minutes. I think some folks
just
will.
Maybe before you do that, I just need to point out a typo in item 62 before you do it on block. Item 62, the numbers were last year's numbers. The new numbers never got updated. So the dates are all right, but it should, instead of 465, it should be 533,790. And instead of 1695800, it should be 1798139. Those were the numbers that you reviewed with the school board. So that was my error in not updating those numbers.
Okay. Thank you, Mike. Just wait a couple more minutes while... Two minutes, yep.
2 minutes.
2 minute recess, but only two. Okay, so I think we'll get started again. Our 2 minutes are up. So moving on, are we all set? Yes, thank you. So moving on, we'll go to item 59, which is to look at considering items 60 through 73 on block. So I need a motion to, first of all, consider them on block.
The first is to the town council vote to consider items 60 through 73 on block.
Thank you, Jim. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Jamie. Any discussion?
Everybody has the correction on item 62? There is a correction of the numbers. Yes. We all have that.
Michael gave them to us. So all in favor? Okay, 7-0. Okay, now we want to see about a motion to approve 60 through 73 as presented. Jim?
I order that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council approve items 60 through 73.
Thank you. Is there a second? Jessica? Sorry. Thank you. Any discussion? Any of the items? No? All in favor? Thank you. 7-0. And now we run over to the item 75, which is the proposed zoning amendment. And I'm going to turn this over to Patty to give us some updates.
Great. I'm going to ask the council to approve a motion, which I'll make in a bit, to refer a proposed zoning amendment to the planning board for review. Let me just give you a little bit of background. I'm bringing this to town council because the town council approved the town center plan in last November 2014. There were seven goals in the plan, a number of which needed some further work and consideration by the town. Number two was regarding speed limits in the town. We've already sent that off and addressed that and sent that to with more conversation through MDOT. The fourth goal is was in the town center plan created as a desire to create gathering places in town center where businesses and shops will be built around a town green. So current zoning as it stands, smartly, I believe, requires businesses to be set back and have setbacks from when they're situated on the main road, 25 and 35 feet for minimum and maximum setbacks. They also require that there be pedestrian space in the front where there be sidewalks put in and, you know, lampposts and the things that are based on town center standards. While this is great, what it does not allow for is as some of these the real estate's, you know, purchased and proposed to be built in town does not allow. The current zoning doesn't allow for the potential for a town center green, because the concept of the green is to have businesses surrounding a green which would front these businesses, whereas our current zoning would require that the buildings be built up front with parking, and then if there were ever a green, it would be behind, and it would therefore not work for as an appropriate gathering space. So if you look at in your packet there, you have Appendix H from the town center plan, which suggests a draft zoning amendment, and this would allow a change in the zoning setbacks specifically for a town center green. So with that, before we have some discussion, I guess what I will do is put on the floor for you a motion. I move that the town council refer to the planning board the sample text amendment, which is Town Center Plan Appendix H, you have there, to consider modifying the Town Center minimum maximum setbacks requirement when specifically a village green is proposed.
Thank you, Patty. Mm-hmm. Is there a second?
Seconded.
Thank you, Jim. Discussion?
I'd
Jim.
Like to compliment our town councilor on her motion and a well-thought-out memo to support it. That's mm-hmm. great. Appreciate that. Mm-hmm.
Anybody else? No? Okay. All in favor? 7-0. And I believe, I'm hoping, almost last, second to last. Item number 76 is the approval of the warrant for the vote on the school budget. Based on this evening's vote, is there a motion to approve the warrant? The wording of the warrant. Jessica?
I so move.
Thank you. Is there a second? Molly, thank you.
I'll second that.
Discussion? Caitlin?
Question about the wording. Is that what it's always read every year, about the adopt the latest school budget meeting of the town council? I just want to get, after what we've all gone through, is it clear which budget is being adopted, do you favor approving the Town of Cape Elizabeth school budget for the upcoming year that was adopted at the latest school budget meeting of the Town Council? So I just, if anybody else sees any confusion.
Deborah, address that, please.
That's the language in the law. We can't put any more specifics. Board will be providing us with a list of numbers that we'll be posting for absentee balloting, which will be beginning tomorrow morning through June 4th, which is a deadline Thursday prior. So it is,
it is what it is.
It is.
Not a problem.
But thank you for asking the question, because other people might have the same question. Yeah. So, other questions? No? Okay. Then all in favor? 7-0. And then the last item is item 77. And Michael, this is the approval of the collective bargaining agreement with the Cape Elizabeth Police Association for the next 3 years. Michael, did you want to address
this? Yes. This is in keeping with the bargaining instructions that the Town Council had given me. The association still hasn't approved it, but I think your vote will be an indication to them of your support for it. There's one little wrinkle which I really, it might cause a problem. I don't know, but we'll see. But I would recommend it be approved. It is a 3-year agreement. It's 2.5% each year. The entire agreement is published with the materials for this meeting online, if anyone would like to look at the draft agreement.
Thank you, Michael.
Maybe, I know the council has access to it, but everyone has access to it if anyone wants to see it.
Okay.
And that's one thing. There's really no change from what you've heard. And, usually most, I think we're, talk about transparency. I think we're the only public body that publishes the draft collective bargaining agreement online a week before the meeting so anyone could see it. So, I think that's just in keeping what happens. So.
Thank you, Michael. So is there a motion to approve the collective bargaining agreement? Molly?
Move to approve the collective bargaining agreement with the Cape Elizabeth Police Association for the next 3 years.
Thank you. Is there a second? Jessica, thank you. Discussion? Any more questions for Michael on it? No? All right, then all in favor? 7-0. Citizens may raise a point in this about any topic that's not on the agenda. So is there anyone here that wants to speak to the...
I would.
Yes? Okay.
If you notice, I just wanted to point out...
You're a citizen.
The wording on this says, citizens may at this point in the meeting raise any topic that is not on the agenda that pertains to local government. That's actually new language, and I wanted to make sure you didn't have an objection to it. It always has said citizens discussion about it's not on the agenda. One, that seems some confusion. And two, this language does draft it that there has to be some pertinence to local government. You can't come to the meeting and talk about grain prices or it has to be somehow pertinent to local government. Because some people in other communities have used these opportunities as a forum just to talk about whatever they want to talk about. But if you have concerns with this language, let me know and we'll revert back to the old language.
Okay. All right, so I will then...
Okay.
Then I will ask, is there anybody here that wants to speak to us about something that's not been on the agenda? No? Okay. Then I will let Mike know if you have some concerns with the wording, and I will entertain a motion to adjourn.
Move to adjourn.
Thank you, Molly. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Jim. All in favor? Thank you very much.